So public universities are considered governmental entities, and they are bound by the principles of the First Amendment. So students, faculty, and staff at public universities, as well as potential speakers who want to speak at public universities, do have First Amendment rights. And one of the key principles under the First Amendment is that the government, including public universities, cannot discriminate against viewpoints. And so the University of Florida, as is the University of Central Florida and all public universities in the state of Florida, already must subscribe and abide by the principles of the First Amendment, freedom of speech, as well as the right to peaceably assemble. So that raises a real question: what is the purpose of this legislation if viewpoint diversity already is protected under the First Amendment, and governmental entities, including universities, must comply with that? So it leads to one possible kind of nefarious suggestion or answer to that question, and that is that the results of the survey, the data, could be used to possibly withhold money or funding from state appropriations to universities that lawmakers in Tallahassee may feel somehow do not adequately promote a diverse marketplace of ideas or political climate on campus. So that's the potential downside of this. It could be used as a weapon or a tool to withhold funding. And of course, the issue is really, how is one going to define what is or is not truly a diverse marketplace of ideas? There's no definition of that in this legislation.
Supporters of the move say it's intended to ensure First Amendment rights that are already ensured, but you've said it could do the opposite by having a chilling effect on speech. Why is that?
There is a potential that the law will have a chilling effect and lead to self-censorship of professors in the classroom who may be afraid of speaking out about particular controversial viewpoints for fear that a student will take that as an endorsement of those viewpoints. Not simply, I'm proposing, here's a viewpoint, here's one possibility you should understand. And then in turn, that student may essentially report that professor to the lawmakers in Tallahassee. In other words, a chilling effect on speech in the classroom. So there's a great irony here. While this is intended to promote a diverse marketplace of ideas, it actually may backfire in that the professors will stay away from discussing controversial viewpoints simply for fear that those viewpoints will be taken as the professor's endorsement, not simply debating and discussing them.
Now, in the legislation, intellectual freedom and viewpoint diversity are defined as, quote, the exposure of students, faculty, and staff to, and the encouragement of, their exploration of a variety of ideological and political perspectives. Is there any evidence to suggest that higher education stifles free speech by conservatives, as some claim?
I don't know if there's really evidence to support that thesis, but it certainly is a thesis that you hear bandied about, that public universities lean to the left when it comes to political viewpoints, especially in colleges of liberal arts, and not necessarily in business schools or business colleges, but in that area. But in terms of, is there actual hard evidence to support that? I'm really not aware of that. I think most professors try to do their best to show both sides in the classroom. And that's the way my perception is. Now, I'm simply an N of one. It's just my perception of that. I teach free speech, and of course, the First Amendment is viewpoint neutral. It doesn't say good speech or bad speech, Republican or Democrat speech, and that's a very important principle. It just says Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. So I try to teach that, and I try to make that clear to the students that viewpoints on all topics, you know, are allowed. It's not like you can only say pro-choice and not pro-life. You could say vice versa, whatever it is. You can say all viewpoints on that topic. So I think most professors do try to create a fair and open marketplace of ideas in the classroom. I'd add this, that the United States Supreme Court has made it clear that public universities are the quintessential marketplaces of ideas. Both the classroom and the surrounding environs are to be considered marketplaces of ideas. And so, you know, when we go back to this legislation, you know, on the one hand, we could say it's well-intended, that indeed we should have a diverse marketplace of ideas on campus. The question is this legislation really necessary to ensure that?
But can universities actually be sure that they're getting an accurate picture of what the prevalence of views are on campus? They can't force students or staff to take these surveys, can they?
That's correct, that the survey is mandated to be given out by public universities or state universities, but there's no mandate that students, staff, and faculty actually fill it out. So then there comes the question, kind of almost a response bias, who are going to be the more likely students to respond to it? And probably I would bet, and it's just a guess, but I would suspect the students who are more likely to respond to it are those who somehow feel aggrieved or hurt or feel that they've been inculcated or indoctrinated by a professor with a particular viewpoint in the classroom. And maybe that student hasn't done well in that class. And so in other words, that student may have a particular axe to grind. So then the question is, who's filling out the surveys? And I would suspect that the vast majority of students who do get surveys every day or close to every day would say, why should I spend another, you know, however long this takes to fill out, and we don't know what it's going to look like, another 10 to 15 to 20 minutes doing this. I'm feeling things are okay, so I'm not going to fill it out. So in other words, those who respond may be a skewed group of individuals who either from the left or the right feel that somehow their viewpoints are not being allowed to be expressed.
But does this law have any teeth? Because the bill doesn't specify any benchmarks that institutions need to achieve in terms of viewpoint diversity or penalties for institutions, even though the governor says the state won't be funding what he called hotbeds of stale ideology going forward.
Right. So we don't know what the ultimate penalty would be if the lawmakers in Tallahassee were to find out or believe in their judgment that there is a skewed marketplace of ideas, that it's not sufficiently diverse in terms of ideological viewpoints on campus. We don't know really what the outcome would be for that. We could speculate that it would be the withholding of funding down the line, but we absolutely have no idea what it would really be at this point.
You know, this is another polarizing issue, right, that seems to have boiled up over the last year, many of which have First Amendment implications, don't they?
Well, I think there's a lot of legislation right now in Florida that affects free speech that we can think about. We have the anti-riot legislation that was passed and the Governor DeSantis signed into law. We have at the elementary and grade school level, high school level, the you cannot teach critical race theory type of legislation going on. We also have the big tech bill, as it were, that Governor DeSantis signed, stating that social media platforms that have very vast and large subscriberships and revenue bases cannot deplatform a candidate for either state or local office in the state of Florida based upon their viewpoints. And so really we've a spate of at least, including this bill then, that's four pieces of legislation that have gone through that to some extent do affect free speech rights and implicate First Amendment rights too. When it comes to what's taught on a university campus, we generally think of that in terms of academic freedom. And academic freedom can be perceived as not necessarily the academic freedom of the individual professor, but also what we would call institutional academic freedom, the ability of a public university to choose who gets to teach the courses, what's taught in those courses, and how they're taught. And that's a major premise or principle of it, that the legislature should kind of pull back and kind of respect that deference under that notion of institutional academic freedom. So yes, this is part of a wave of legislation in Florida. And at the public university level, as I think I've mentioned before, there is a perception, at least among conservatives, that there is a liberal bias. Whether that's right or wrong, is another matter. And so this legislation politically kind of panders to that conservative base's belief and ideology that academia, public universities are skewed to the left and liberal leaning.